We're here today to celebrate the life of Gail Stewart. I want to thank you for coming, being a part of this, a lady that touched many lives. She touched your life or you wouldn't be here. Death can do a lot of things, but it can't take our memory. But the Bible says, who can separate us from the love of God? It says, neither death nor life. So today we're here to celebrate her life. And she was larger than life. She's touched many lives and been a blessing to many people. Let us pray. Precious God, we love you today. We thank you, Lord, for every blessing of life. We thank you for the life of Gail. We ask your blessings, God, upon her family today and friends and neighbors and all those that's come this way. Ask you, God, to touch RL and those today, God, that you might just wrap your arms around them, Lord. And we ask, God, for you to be a part of this service today. Lord God, overlook each and every heart that's here this day, God. And Lord, I pray, God, that you might bless it, Lord God, and touch it and heal it, God, today, and let them know, Lord, this is not the end, it's the only, the beginning. And we'll ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
With that quiet, oh, Amen. With arms wide open, he's pardoned Miss Gail today. And she's at home in heaven. We're gathered here today to celebrate the life of Miss Gail Stewart, my friend and my sister in Christ. I'd like to share a scripture with you, very familiar. If you were here at this Grace's funeral, you heard it. It's John chapter 14, verses 2 and 3. It says, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." Let us pray. Lord, I thank you for your blessings upon us, God. I thank you for everything that you do for us. Most of all, God, I thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, that gives us hope this morning, God. I thank you for the life that you shared, Miss Gail, with us, dear Lord, and the family and friends, God. I ask, Lord, you bless the family, dear Lord, Ariel, Julie, the grandchildren, God, and our sons that come to be here today. And we give you all the glory and the praise, and we love you and have your way in this service. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Miss Gail lived a life of 74 years. She had ups and downs, just like all of us do. But she fought the fight, and she won the war. And now she is home in heaven with her Savior, Jesus Christ, because she made him Lord and Savior of her life. She was a loving and generous person. She loved Ariel, and they'd been together for 34 years. She worked with the youth at the church, and she loved the kids, but she said some of them needed a belt. She loved going to Bible study on Monday night and would tell me all about it on Wednesday. She was a nurse for 40 years, and she still looked after family and friends even after she retired. She loved Julie as she was her own daughter. She loved her grandchildren, and Mason was the alpha rider. She loved her sister, and she loved her Aunt Louise, and they were more like sisters. She loved the boys, and she would often tell me about them. Pray for them. The family would give me some things that they would like to share today. This is from Ariel. Her daddy put her on a tractor at 4 years old. That is when her love for a tractor started. She would jump on her tractor and do anything she wanted until the last few years. She loved mowing grass. First job was at the Gerald plant in Smithfield. She then decided to go to nursing school, and she earned a 4-year nursing degree and worked at Johnson Memorial and Wilson Memorial for over 40 years. She worked in all areas of the hospital for Duke Lifeline, which she loved. When some of the doctors saw her coming, they would hide to avoid her. She cut them no slack. She had a way of controlling the doctors. She was a mentor and an educator for lots of nurses at Johnson Community College, Barton College, and satellite courses for Duke. Her motto was, "Work hard while you can, because one day I will not be able to work." She was headstrong and unique. She had a good heart and sacrificed herself to help others. She worked hard to provide for her boys and spoil them. A few days after her surgery at Duke, her doctor was standing over her when she opened up her eyes and she said, "I don't know who you are, but if you don't get out of my face, I'm gonna hit you." The doctor turned and told RL she's ready to go home. She loved her church and the youth. When she hurt a child or someone in need, she would give money to someone to help them. This is from Mason. He loved Mongo because she rode him on the tractor. She read the Bible to him, and she played ball with him. This is from Julie. I've been in her life for 26 years. She was like a mom, sister, and a best friend. The daughter by choice she never had. Gail loved my children. She was always helping me in many ways. She was so proud of me and my kids. She went wide open all the time. She was a tiny woman, but she was large and in charge. She loved her hymns. Almost every time I went to her house, she was listening to the Gaithers and praising the Lord. As much as Miss Gail done in this life, it wasn't enough. What secured her home in heaven was her acceptance as Jesus Christ, as her Lord and Savior. Now, death's coming to each and every one of us. We're not immune to it. Unless you go in the rapture, you will go by the grave. And the Bible says it's appointed a man to die once. Then comes the judgment. And your body's going to go back to the earth. But your soul will live forever in one or two places, heaven or hell. And what determines where your soul will spend eternity is what you've done with the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you will see her again. But if you haven't, you won't.
I'd like to do one of my favorite gospel songs. Just features the stems also. How great thou art.
How great.
Heard all the things that Curtis has said about Gail, and they're all true. But I want to tell you what I know. He's told us that Gail gave, and she did, and she shared her life with a lot of folks. There's no doubt about it. She was larger than life. But I want to remind you today, the reason we have joy and peace today is because, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. I went to see Gail at the nursing home, and we sat around and talked a good while, and R.L. had told me that she was non-responsive. Doctors said they didn't know if she heard you or not, and we talked a while, and we said we'd sit there and we're going to have prayer. As we started, I reached out and I took her by the left hand. And when I did, she squeezed my hand. And then she let go. She didn't squeeze it anymore. But she let me know. She knew what we were going to do, and she knew that prayer was the key. So I want to talk to you today about what I know. I know that God uses death as a vehicle to take us out of this world. It's never welcomed. But the truth is, the Bible says that God looks ahead of what we're going to face, and sometimes he pulls us out early to keep us from going through what we were going through. And the truth is, Gail was facing problems. And God saw fit to take her out. So God gave his Son the day that we might have hope. Gail's hope was not in what she had given away. Her hope was not in that. Her hope was in the God that gave his Son that she might live and not die. When Jesus came, you see, God didn't need anything. There's not one thing in the world that you can give God. He don't need anything. He created this world. He created us. He has need of absolutely nothing. There is not one reason in the world that God should care about us, but yet he does. For God said, I so loved the world that I gave my Son. So let me say today, it weren't enough for him to ride boats and walk by the shores of Galilee. It weren't enough for him to be cold and hungry and thirsty. on enough one to pray till his blood turned to great drops of sweat. He had to go to a cross called Calvary. And there they laid him on that cross and they nailed him to that cross. Isaiah said it was a nail in a sure place. In other words, it was an anchor for the soul. Can I tell you today, there is an anchor that holds. It holds beyond the problems of this world. It holds beyond the grave. There is an anchor today that you can anchor your soul in, that you do not have to worry when this day comes. Gail, anchor her soul. Anchoring does not mean that you cannot fluctuate. It does not mean that you cannot go up, and it does not mean you cannot go down. It does not mean you can move from side to side. It just means this: after you go so far, there is an anchor that will not let you go any further.
Amen.
So she anchored her soul in something that would hold. She anchored her soul in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was nailed to a cross and he died till the sun refused to shine. He died till the earth shake. He died till the veil in the temple was rent in two, into the Holy of Holies, that we do not have to stand on the outside anymore. You can approach God. God says, come unto me boldly. All that are in need, come unto me. Let me tell you something. We're here today and we have joy in our hearts and peace in our hearts today because we know the anchor holds. I went to the funeral home last night, and when I walked in the door, there was a little old boy there, Mason. He looked at me, and here's what he done. I got to him. You know what he said, R.L.? He said, "Man, and here, she's gone on to heaven. She's going to be with the Lord." And here's what he said, so profound. It's hard to, many adults in here can say what that young man said. He said, now, preacher, he says, we have no guarantee of life. He says, we don't know if we'll make it through today or not. We don't know if tomorrow, but we know we're going to heaven when we leave this world. Can I tell you something? Gail, I say, done a good job teaching that young man because he knows about God. And let me tell you something, that's worth more than the biggest bank account you got. Knowing Jesus Christ today is worth it all, because everybody's going to come to this point in life. And when you do, it's a good thing to know the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
I didn't come to preach, but I can. He said she'd gone to heaven. Jesus said, I go to prepare you a place, that where I am, there you may be also. In other words, I'm going away and I'm going to fix a place, but I'm not fixing it for me alone. I'm fixing it we can have it together. They tell me there's gates of pearl. They tell me there's streets of gold. They tell me there's a great white throne. They tell me there's a river of life. They tell me that the trees bear fruit all year long. But I got news for you. Some say that's not true. Don't matter to me. I believe there is a place that God has prepared for the people that love Him.
Amen.
I really, really believe that. But if that is not the case, if we get to the pearly gates in a plastic field, I still want to go. If we get to the pearly gates and the great white throne judgment has a dingy look, I still want to go. If we get there and the river of life is a babbling brook, I still want to go. If I get there and my mansion is one room in a terrible view, I still want to go. I'm here today to tell you God is everything when it comes to a day like today.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Like I say, I didn't come to preach.
But I can tell you something. Everybody needs to know there is a God in heaven that loves you enough that He gave His Son on the cross to die for you. And Mason told me last night, he said, Preacher Freddie, he said, hadn't been to church right lately. He said, I've been tied up with school. I said, well, Mason, we're ready to go. He said, yes, I'm ready to go to heaven. Praise the Lord. Let me tell you something. It's a good thing to know.
Amen.
You're on your way to heaven.
Amen.
And if you've not made Jesus Lord of your life, don't care about your past. Don't make one hill of beans to God what you've done or ain't done. But if you'll call on His name,
Amen.
He'll be an anchor for your soul that when this day comes for you,
yes, He will.
They can say, so-and-so has gone on to be with the one they love. Amen. You know, that's a good thing to be with the one you love. Isn't it? I don't mind being with my grandchildren a bit in the world because I love them. I don't mind being with my wife a bit in the world because I love them.
Praise the Lord.
Gail don't mind being where she's at today because she loves the one that died for her.
Yes.
And I hope you do too.
Amen. Praise
God, I love you and I thank you, God, for your spirit and your love. And I pray you bless this people today. In Jesus' name I do ask it. Forever. Amen.
Thank you. soon. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I appreciate that. Thank you.
I saw one person that was here and I said, it's good to see you for 2 times, but they didn't open that you're saying.
I completely understand.
I said, I don't want to send them in here.
I completely understand.
But you don't.
Chad, I've got them all.
Well, let's wait a long time.